Hi, my name is James Riley from the Wisconsin Historical Fencing Association.
And I'm Matt Zagrillo.
We're here today to discuss the Zornhau and some of the techniques that can be performed corresponding to the opponent's action after the Zornhau is completed. So the way that the Zornhau works is it's an action that happens in response to an opponent's cut. And so if my opponent begins his cut, what I'm going to do is I'm going to extend my sword over his, what Liestenauer describes as falling with the long edge onto his sword. Now we know that what Liestenauer is not telling us to do is to try and strike our opponent in that action. If my opponent cuts at me, and then I attempt to strike my opponent in that action, what I've done is I've actually given him control of the center and created a threat for myself. So instead, as he cuts, what I'm going to do is I'm going to extend my sword across my opponent. What that's going to do is it's going to give me control of the center. If my opponent doesn't respond from here, I'm just going to shoot the point into his face. All right? What Liestenauer describes as the Zorn order. Now from here, from this position of strength that we achieve in the Zornhau, my opponent cuts in, and I respond by extending my sword over his, my opponent can respond in a variety of different ways. If my opponent decides to parry in a strong way by taking back control of the center line, there are a number of options, what Liestenauer calls chief techniques, that I can perform from that angle. On the other hand, if my opponent instead decides to parry in a less optimal way by extending his hilt or by lifting his hilt, then this is what Liestenauer kind of describes as a weak parry. Now, Liestenauer used the term strong and weak a number of times. When he used it to describe the parts of the blade, but also he uses it to describe what I think is this angle. A lot of people think that what Liestenauer means by strong and weak here is if they're pushing hard, or if they're not pushing hard, if they're soft. And I don't think that that's where he's going with this, and here's the number one reason why. If I extend my sword over my opponent's blade, if he just stays there, in other words, if he's weak, the way that we're using that term, then really he's stopped fighting. And from there, I'm just going to extend my sword into him, and that's going to be the end of it. So I think what Liestenauer is trying to describe when he uses the term weak in this context is the way that my opponent parries, whether or not he uses his hilt to try and push my sword off to the side, or whether or not he uses his angle over my blade to gain control of the center that way. Okay, so now we're going to talk about some of the techniques that Liestenauer describes to be used in this from this position, and they can basically be divided up along those lines. Techniques that are used if the opponent is strong or creates an angle over my sword, or if he's weak and attempts to use his hilt to parry. The first technique that we're going to talk about is the Zucken. My opponent strikes in, I Zornhau. Now from here, Liestenauer tells us to shoot the point. I begin to shoot, and my opponent decides to take a strong angle over my sword. All right, one more time. My opponent strikes, I Zorn. I begin to shoot, my opponent takes a strong angle over my sword, and in that action, I lift my sword up over his sword and strike down. You notice that I struck down the exact same angle that he created in that parry. One more time, my opponent strikes, I create the angle over his sword, I begin my thrust, he pushes off to the side, I lift up and back down, keep your sword up, and what I'm doing here is I'm striking down the exact same angle that he creates with his sword, doing a few things here. Number one, I'm creating a shield, or I'm placing a shield in front of my opponent's sword that's protecting me, and then the other thing that I'm doing is I'm using the minimal movement of my body to be able to deliver an effective strike to my opponent. One last time, he strikes in, I Zorn, I begin to shoot the point, he creates the angle, I come up, over, and strike. Now, this is what I'm going to do if my opponent takes control of the line, but does so in a way that's not very aggressive. If my opponent is being extremely aggressive in the moment, so he strikes in, I get the Zorn Howe, I begin my thrust, and he pushes my sword way off to the side, I'm going to wind my sword around his blade, and this is what Lichtenauer calls the duplirin. So, again, my opponent strikes in, I take control, I begin my thrust, he takes an aggressive parry, and from here, I just stab. And the reason that I'm able to do this is because in that aggressive parry that my opponent took, I wasn't under threat from his point. He's basically decided that saving his life was more important than keeping his threat on me, which in the end is what got him killed. One last time, he strikes in. Again, I'm taking control of the center. This is what Zorn Howe means. From here, I begin my thrust. He pushes his sword off to the side, and I do clearing around his sword. There's one last action that we're going to do from Zorn Howe. If my opponent is strong in the bind, meaning he extends his sword over mine to create his parry, I gain my Zorn. My opponent begins to extend his sword over mine to gain the angle, but he does so with his strong on my weak. As he does, I'm going to release my sword from his, and I'm just going to turn my long edge into his sword as I begin my thrust. One more time. My opponent strikes. I gain control of the center. He begins to push my sword aside with his strong and my weak. And I turn my sword in here. And this is what Lichtenauer calls the perspective. So that's three different types of parries that he can make in a strong way by extending his sword over mine. And it's three different actions that I can do three different actions that I can do depending on how he, where in the bind or how aggressively he goes to execute those strong parries. Now, if we talk, if we go to the other side of the parry situation, my opponent strikes in, I gain the Zorn Howe, and now from here, my opponent begins to lift up his arms, and this is what Lichtenauer is referring to when he describes weak, and I'm going to do the opposite of the duplirin, and I'm going to move Tirin around the opportunity that he's giving me. Right, one last time. What's important here is that I take a large step in with my left, and what that's going to do is it's going to make it so that I'm past this point, it's no longer a threat to me. This time, take control of my opponent's sword, he begins to lift, and let me turn in. If my opponent strikes in at me, and I take the Zorn Howe, and my opponent decides that he wants to parry my sword in a weaker way, but in an aggressive way, to make sure that I'm not able to get my point online for his strike. From here, what I'm going to do is what Lichtenauer calls hand trucking. I'm going to bring my sword underneath, and I'm going to place it on his hands. From here, I'm going to turn that into what Lichtenauer describes as turning an understitch into an overstitch, just by gaining control of his hands to push him away as I create more space for myself. So again, he strikes in. I begin my Mutirin because he's weak, and he pushes my point aside. I get underneath his hand, and I throw him off. Okay. So these are the hop stoop that Lichtenauer has. These are six of the hop stoop that Lichtenauer has in his glossary. And really, this is just the beginning of understanding how he's integrated the hop stoop into the master cut plays. Particularly this play with Zornhau. What's most important about Zornhau is it starts with taking control of the center by extending our sword over our opponents. And then depending on what he does from here, I'm going to respond with the corresponding hop stoop or chief technique.